Well, I remember Gough as having a sense of Australian identity, a sense of Australia's purpose as a nation, not as an appendage to other nations. His first visit to China was criticized at the time, but it was before Nixon opened the door to China. My first visit overseas was to Japan and China was really the target of that visit, because I wanted China to understand that the policies that Gough had introduced were bipartisan policies for Australia, and that it was not only he and the Labour Party, but I and the Liberal Party thought the relationship was enormously important for Australia in future years. So in external things, there are many, he touched Australian life in so many ways, in arts, music, opera, ballet, perhaps in literature more than anything else. People felt, I think, released, able to write what they might not have been able to write before. I think they could always write exactly what they wanted, but there was a new spirit abroad which he seemed to introduce and which infected people in positive ways.
And as a man, how will you remember him?
Larger than life sometimes, most formidable opponent in political terms, but as somebody who was clearly very, very close to Margaret, somebody who was very close to his family, as somebody who I like to believe became a good friend.
And of course you did become good friends, but of course your names will always be linked because of what happened in 1975. How were you able to sort of build the bridges after that in subsequent years?
Well, it happened little by little. I don't think Gough ever, I never felt he bore me personal animosity. I think he regarded that as politics. And we met at different times, mostly overseas when I was also out of Parliament. Not at any length, but the ice started to break. Then we found ourselves on the back of a semi-trailer supporting the independence of the Melbourne Age. We found that we had a number of issues, domestic and international, where we had views in common. And that, I think, established the basis of a relationship.
In 1975, what was it like, though, between the two of you?
Oh, it was a fierce political battle. And there were tense times, difficult times.
Do you now look back and have regrets from about 1975?
I don't think that's the... if you like, I might regret the larger political argument and the way that did become divisive in Australia. I think... but I'm not going to talk about... regretting particular actions or whatever, because I don't think this is the time to do this. I think it's a time to remember the things that Gough contributed to Australia, and whether that's a relationship with Vincent Mingiari, which led to land rights, which my government actually introduced, because when the report came down, he wasn't in office. But there are a number of things that fell into that category where he had, in a sense, opened the door to policy.
Okay. How would you describe some of his greatest achievements?
Well, they were substantial. They changed the way Australia looked at herself in significant ways. It was a more open society and in some ways a more questioning society.
And of course, at the time you couldn't say it, but... do you believe he was a good Prime Minister?
Oh, let's say he was a Prime Minister who did many different things. He had great ambitions for Australia, and many of his ideas were good. But, and if he thought he had a grand idea, he'd want to implement it forthwith. And if he had a fault, maybe he tried to do too much too quickly. Now, that's not necessarily a fault of his. It's perhaps a fault in part The Labour Party had been out of office for 23 years, and he especially had built an agenda for the Labour Party, which he wanted to see fulfilled as quickly as possible.
Were you surprised though with the...
Australia's seen as a strong democracy, Mr. Fraser. How do you think Gough Whitlam contributed to that?
A strong democracy?
A strong democracy.
Well, that's really getting to the point of 1975, which I don't think has ever really been understood. And I'm not sure that, you know, this to me isn't the environment to go into that. It really isn't, because, you need to go back to history. If a government can't get its budget through the parliament, what does a government do? There were alternatives. And, Gough could have gone to that election as prime minister. And it would have been better, perhaps, if he had. But he didn't want to take that path.
Given the division at the time, are you surprised that you ended up on good terms with him in a friendship group?
No, I don't think so, because I never regarded whatever he said about me as personally directed. I regarded it as politics, and I think he regarded what I did in those times also as politics, and not to be taken personally by him. But quite apart from that, he wasn't the sort of person who bore grudges and carried bitterness into the future. He was a much larger man than that, a more generous man than that.
When you first heard that famous speech on the steps of old Parliament, Kerr's Kerr, and, God save the Queen, what was your first reaction when you heard those words?
Oh, I probably flinched a bit. But I'd had many darts aimed at my back, if you like, and you develop a thick skin in politics. If you don't, it's probably very difficult to survive. And some of the toughest darts had in very early times been thrown at me by the Liberal Party. So, perhaps that inured me to that comment.
You mentioned he was a formidable man. When he stood up in Parliament, he was renowned as an orator. You saw it firsthand, obviously. Just how daunting was it to face off with him in Parliament when he was on a roll?
It was daunting. You had to be careful what you say. If you made a mistake, he'd pick up on it very, very quickly and would make you pay a price for it in debating terms. But it was also a time when there were a significant number of good debaters in the Parliament. On the Liberal side, Jim Killen. Labour still had Clive Cameron, but Eddie Ward was one of the most formidable debaters, which you might not have expected. Fred Daly, Paul Keating was seen to show that he was a very able, effective and vigorous debater, probably nearer to the Whitlam tradition than any of the others. Gough, because of the completeness of the man, was probably the most formidable debater when he put his mind to it.
What do you think modern-day politicians could take away as his legacy or learn from what he did?
Oh, Australia should be Australia. That we are not a plaything for another country. That we're an independent country with our own mind, our own heart. And we stand for what we believe, not for what somebody tells us to believe. And if there's any criticism in that, it's a criticism of the Parliament, with very, very minor exceptions. It's not a criticism of one political party or the other. And that might be, to me, the fact that he had a view of Australia and Australia's place in the world, and Australia being Australia, not better than other countries, but different from other countries, simply because we are Australia. And therefore, we needed to be independent. He had a sense of that, and was the first Prime Minister to have a sense of that. Something that we've lost over the last 20, 25 years.
When did you last speak to him?
Sometime earlier this year, in his office.
Can you share what you talked about?
Oh, we probably didn't talk about anything all that important. I was just calling on him to pay my respects and say hello. He'd been in a nursing home, and it had become a little difficult to have a vigorous conversation. But when I went to Sydney, I'd contact his office and find out if he's going to... He was still going to his office three or four times a week. He had an absolutely devoted staff who looked after him in many ways. And they'd help to keep the ball rolling if he was at a loss for a word or something.